So I've been looking for big news stories today in the gaming world. Seems to be a pretty slow news day because I couldn't find anything. Yesterday I found a lot of stories. I found a story about Take-Two and the story about Microsoft and what was the other big story? EA buying Respawn for $400 million. But today I kept looking and looking and looking. I couldn't really find anything that was at least relevant enough to make a whole video dedicated to it. So because of that, I won't be covering any big news stories today because there don't seem to be any. But moving on, I thought that it would be pretty interesting to discuss the best console generation ever. Now, I'm pretty sure there's going to be some controversy about this video because a lot of people are probably going to disagree with me. But usually, when people talk about what the best generation was, it's always the one that they grew up with as a kid. Always. It's never any other generation. It's always the one that they grew up with. So if somebody grew up during the Super Nintendo days, they're definitely going to say that's the best generation. It happens. And I'm not blaming people for doing that. It's just I'm just making a point that usually people cloud their better judgment in favor of nostalgia. I mean, it happens a lot. Nostalgia is a very powerful thing. Sometimes it's good. A lot of times it's not good. But at least when it comes to my opinion, I don't really think that people can accuse me of just letting nostalgia completely affect my opinion. And I'm saying that because I've lived through four console generations so far. The fifth generation, sixth, seventh, and eighth, of course. First console I was ever exposed to as a kid was the Nintendo 64. The first console I ever owned was the PS2. And when I had the PS2, I ended up getting a lot of PS1 games because I never owned a PS1, but the PS2 was backwards compatible, so I was able to play PS1 games. That's how I was exposed to Crash Bandicoot, Spyro, and all those other amazing games that defined the fifth generation. So while I might have been too young to be able to experience, to have experienced the fifth generation of consoles at its height, I think it's still a fair thing to say that I did still grow up with the fifth generation because by the time I was a toddler, fifth generation consoles were discontinued. But like I said, through backwards compatibility, I experienced the fifth generation alongside the sixth generation. And I love the fifth generation. I love the N64 games because my sister had an N64 and I played with her all the time when I was a very young child, like 3, 4 years old. And of course, I also played the shit out of PS1 games through backwards compatibility. And we will talk about backwards compatibility later, because that's something else we're talking about. But since my childhood consisted of the fifth generation and the sixth generation, and it wasn't really until I was a preteen that I really got exposed to the seventh generation, I wouldn't say that nostalgia is really affecting my opinion on this one. I think it has more to do with how truly amazing gaming was back then in the seventh generation. Not to say that gaming in the sixth and fifth generation was bad. Obviously, I'm not saying that because fifth, sixth generation gaming was amazing. And as a matter of fact, I believe that the fifth and sixth generation was better than the current generation of consoles, which I feel has been very disappointing, and I know a lot of people agree with me. But before I get into specific reasons as to why I believe that the seventh generation was the greatest console generation ever, let's get into some background information about me and my experiences with the seventh generation so you guys have a better idea of where I'm coming from. So as we all know, the seventh generation consisted of the Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, and the Wii. Those were the three main consoles. There were also some other little consoles, but they weren't, I guess, mainstream enough for them to be included in anything. I'm talking about the Hyperscan and the Chintendo V, which is the Chinese knockoff of the Wii. There were some other consoles, but they're not even worth mentioning at all. So we're not even going to talk about those. But the first seventh generation console that I was exposed to, that I owned, was the Nintendo Wii. Now, I know a lot of Nintendo fans are going to be upset with me saying this, but I felt that the Wii was more of a children's toy than an actual gaming machine. And I honestly think that the Wii should be viewed separately from the PS3/360. So when I'm really talking about seventh generation, I'm mainly talking about the 360 and the PS3. But the Wii was also, I'm not saying the Wii was a bad console. It's just that it was more of a children's toy than an actual gaming machine. Just look at all the games that they had. Most of their games were just shovelware products that were used to capitalize on the motion gimmick. And this isn't to say that the Wii wasn't one of my best birthday presents I've ever gotten, because the Wii was amazing. I loved playing with the Mii. I loved playing Wii Sports. I loved doing all the shit that I was able to do on the Wii, Super Mario Galaxy. I loved the Wii. But within a year, the Wii kind of got a little boring to me. I was kind of tired of playing the Wii. I went back to the PS2. The PS2 became my main console again. But the funny thing is that shortly after I got the Wii, I actually got an Xbox 360. It was the Xbox 360 Arcade, which was the cheapest version of the 360. I know I told this story very recently, but I'll tell it again just because it's very relevant for this video. The only reason why I had the 360, though, in the first place was because my mom won a lottery. She went to one of those lottery events. You know, those fundraisers where you do a raffle. My mom went to one of those, and she actually won an Xbox 360 Arcade. And I played it, but the reason why I didn't get into the 360, and the reason why that didn't become my main console, was because I didn't have a hard drive. The reason why the Xbox 360 Arcade was cheap was because it did not come with a hard drive. And I never ended up getting a hard drive because a hard drive back then was like $100. So yeah, that wasn't happening, at least for a while. And the only games it came with were Lego Indiana Jones, and I believe it was also Lego Batman. And those games were okay, but really weren't enough to get me into the console. And of course, I didn't know what the hell Xbox Live was back then because I was a kid and I didn't really look up stuff on the internet that much. I didn't really know that much about the industry and about what was going on. But really, like I said, the main reason why I didn't get into the 360 was because I didn't have a hard drive. Therefore, I couldn't really get any new games because I would have ran out of space pretty easily. It came with some shitty memory card that didn't even barely held save data for one game. And that was Indiana Jones. So, yeah, I couldn't really get into any more games because of that. To get a hard drive was pretty expensive, and back then, I don't think my parents were willing to... They eventually got it, but this was by the time that I already got my PS3, and I've already told this story, and I'm sure a lot of you guys already know the story because I said it in previous videos, but it was pretty much my 11th birthday. I got it around that time, and I got the fat PS3. Played a few games on that, and I enjoyed it. But eventually, after a very short period of time, actually, it was actually on Christmas Day. What a great Christmas surprise. Christmas Day was when my first PS3 decided to break down and not work anymore. So my parents felt so bad that my console broke down, because obviously they got me PS3 games for Christmas and I couldn't use my Christmas presents, that they actually went out, this was like the day after Christmas or 2 days after Christmas, whatever it was, and actually got me a new console. So that was great of them to do that. They really didn't have to. They could have been tough luck, but they were nice enough to get me a new console. So they got me the PS3 Slim, and that's really when I started go, because I actually had a working console. The fat PS3 that I got was 80 gigabytes, so I couldn't really hold that much data. So I actually ran out of data pretty quickly before the console ended up breaking down anyway. I don't know. It didn't get a yellow light of death. Something fucking happened to it. I don't know why it broke like that, but it broke down. But since the PS3 Slim came with 250 gigabytes, that's when I really started to get going. And also, the PS3 was my first real exposure to online gaming. I never did Xbox Live on the 360. I never played online the PS2. I didn't even know that was a thing until I had the PS3 already. And of course, I played online the Wii, but Wii Online was nothing special. Especially since playing online on the Wii was an absolute bitch. I actually had to call my friend on a phone to actually get a match set up in Mario Kart. Mario Kart Wii. That was fun. Playing online Mario Kart with Wii with my friend was fun. But I remember playing on the PS3, like, man, playing online is so much easier than it's ever been. So I ended up really appreciating that, especially since it was free back then. Now you have to pay for it, but back then, Xbox Live you had to pay for, and PSN was free. So I loved the fact that I had a free service, and I was I just loved PSN back then. PSN back then had its flaws, of course, with Sony getting hacked and all that shit that was going on back then, and there were a lot of issues with PSN. But were there really any more issues back then than there are now, the paid service? How many times on Christmas Day was PS4 servers offline? I remember when I first got the PS4, which was like a month after launch, it was for Christmas. I got lucky, by the way. There were only 6 left PS4s in stock on Amazon. There were only 6 PS4s left, and I actually got my hands on one of them. Very lucky, because back then, I'm sure you guys remember, in 2013, finding a PS4, you were more likely to find a hot 20-year-old virgin than to actually find a PS4 on the shelves. It was a bitch and a half to get the PS4 back then. But I was lucky enough to get it. But when I got it, couldn't use the online features. The online services were fucked up because the servers were clogged up or whatever, which I think is pathetic, honestly. You have a paid service, you have to pay for the service, and you have instances where they're just full days where, oh, the servers are offline because there's too much demand. Big companies like Sony can't handle demand like that. It's ridiculous. But that would be the first reason why I think that the 7th generation is the best generation, because it definitely had a great impact on the gaming industry because it really made online gaming mainstream. I know 6th generation had online gaming, but it's not comparable to how easy it was to get online on 7th generation. Getting on PSN and Xbox Live was easy, unlike the PS2. And it was also the first generation where digital really started taking off. I don't think digital was even a thing back in 6th generation, other than PC, of course. But we're not really talking about PC here. We're talking about console generations. So that's another thing. It kind of goes hand in hand with revolutionizing online gaming. Because of that, it allowed for the digital market to grow rapidly. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm very grateful that I don't have to go to GameStop anymore to get my games, especially when I was like 15, 16. You know, I couldn't go to the fucking GameStop without my mother. They refused to sell me an M-rated game, so that was a bitch. I also don't miss midnight release pre-order lines. I don't miss pre-order lines in general. You know, when a game comes out and you pre-order it and the line is just fucking long, it's out the door. I remember at the mall at GameStop, the line was just crazy whenever a new Call of Duty came out or any other game came out. But because 7th generation really allowed for digital gaming to take off, it really made our lives easier. You know, people say a lot of bad things about digital, how horrible digital is, but I actually prefer digital gaming over buying physical copies of games. You don't have to worry about your game getting scratched, lost, or anything else that can happen. And it's honestly been many, many, many years since I've ever stepped foot into a GameStop. You look at my physical collection for current gen games, and it's pretty small. I maybe have about 5 or 6 eighth generation physical copies, and that's including the PS4 and Xbox One. Now, more recently, I've been buying physical copies of games, but that has more to do with the backwards compatibility thing on the Xbox One. It's much cheaper and much easier to get a physical 360 game than getting a digital 360 game. But yeah, those are definitely two solid reasons why 7th generation was the best generation, because the two biggest innovations that occurred during the 7th generation was online gaming, being able to play online with your friends easily, and using that online connectivity to buy digital goods. Some of my best, and I'm sure anybody who's listening or watching, their best moments probably are online also. Online gaming is great, and the 7th generation really revolutionized online gaming, made it much more mainstream, made it much easier than previous generations that kind of had it going on, but it wasn't really that good, like SegaNet on the Dreamcast, or like I said, the PS2 online. But some of my best memories, like one of my favorite games of all time was Red Dead Redemption, right? Absolutely loved the online. But now that we're talking about games, gaming was fucking on fire. In 2009, 2010, so many amazing games were coming out. 2010 specifically had Red Dead Redemption, which I just mentioned, Call of Duty Black Ops, which is one of my favorite Call of Duties, Battlefield Bad Company 2, which is my favorite Battlefield game ever. One quick thing before I continue, going about Battlefield Bad Company 2. Battlefield Bad Company 2 had one of the greatest DLCs I've ever played. That's the Vietnam expansion. Back then, they knew how to do DLC right. How about Red Dead Redemption, Undead Nightmare, another great DLC? Back then, the 7th generation, I mean, maybe towards the end of the 7th generation, that's when it started really getting cancerous. But 7th generation, when DLC and all these other things were at its infancy, when they were just starting to come out, DLC was fine. I had no problem with DLC. The only shitty thing that I can really think of that was really going on at the time that was fucking awful was probably the online passes. I don't know if you guys remember those. I actually had a conversation with people on Discord about them, and people didn't know what they were. They didn't know what the hell an online pass was, and I was actually amazed. I'm like, am I really getting that old? These people didn't know what an online pass was. So basically, to anybody who doesn't know, an online pass was, it was really first used by EA. They're the ones that really made it a common trend, and then everybody started doing it, was a system that was put in place by game publishers that made you pay extra for the online features. This was for games that had single player and online. At the time, any game that had any kind of online functionality had a online code inside the game that you had to activate in order to be able to play online. So what happens if you buy a game used is that if you buy the game used, then obviously the person who bought it new already entered the code in, so you couldn't use the same code again. So what you had to do is that you had to go to the PlayStation Store, the Xbox Store, whatever, and pay $10, sometimes it was $15, to be able to play the game online. Because what happened was that EA and all these other companies were not happy about used game sales. That's really how GameStop made a lot of its money. And because GameStop was so profitable back then, because the used game market was really profitable back then, EA and all these other companies were really mad that they weren't making any money from those secondhand sales. So that's how the online pass came about. Eventually, EA got rid of the online pass because at that time when the online pass thing was going on, and this is the time when EA was voted the worst company ever 2 years in a row. But that was really the only big controversial thing that was like really awful business practice that was going on back in the 7th generation. There wasn't any microtransactions. There was no $50 season passes for every single game that came out. There were season passes didn't really become prevalent until like the end of the 7th gen, really. So you didn't have it where, I mean, yeah, you did have some instances where you had day one DLC and all this other crap, but it really didn't become huge until 8th generation. That's really when it became a huge mainstream practice by all developers. So that's another thing. I think that compared to the 8th generation, the 7th generation had much less bullshit, which is main reason why I view the 7th generation much more favorably than the 8th generation. But the games, man, the games. 2010, continuing on from the games that I previously mentioned, you had Red Dead Redemption, like I said, Black Ops 1, you had Battlefield Bad Company 2, you also had Mass Effect 2 came out, that was a great game. You had Assassin's Creed, Brotherhood. That was actually, I really enjoyed that game, actually. I really liked the multiplayer in Assassin's Creed back then. When they got rid of the multiplayer, that's when I stopped playing Assassin's Creed, because I thought the multiplayer was fun. But when they got rid of the multiplayer and it was just single player, I'm like, okay, I don't care about this game anymore, because I actually preferred the online over the single player. It's crazy that made sound. I might have been the minority, but still. What other games there were? There was Bioshock 2, Just Cause 2, which I really fucking enjoyed. I thought that was an amazing game. I always loved playing, you know, messing around with the grappling hook. Just Cause 2 was free on PlayStation 4 the other month, and I really couldn't get into it. I really didn't like Just Cause 3. I really couldn't get into it for whatever reason. And of course, there was Fallout New Vegas, which is probably one of the most iconic video games to be ever made. So 2010 was a great year in gaming, probably one of the best years in gaming ever. As was 2009, 2008, and even 2007 was also a great year. I will say, though, the beginning of the 7th generation, the first couple years, was pretty shitty. You had so many hardware malfunctions. Even I had to deal with hardware malfunctions. Sony didn't really get their shit together until the PS3 Slim, which was 2009, with their hardware problems. And the 360, almost the entire time, you had some Red Ring of Death issues. So I'm not trying to say that the entire 7th generation was all peachy and rosy. I'm not trying to to portray the seventh generation as just completely amazing and there were no flaws, no problems whatsoever. But I mean, compared to other generations, not say, like, sixth generation was amazing, right? Sixth generation was great. Fifth generation was great. Fourth, great. Third, great. Not saying these generations were bad. But I'm just, it's just, online gaming is just on a whole different level than anything else I've ever played beforehand. So that's one big reason, again, why I think that this generation was the best. Because online gaming is one of the most important aspects of gaming today. Whether you like it or not, it's true. But the games were also very, very, very amazing back then. There was just so many good games to choose from. I remember it was E3 2010 that I just had a list of all the games that I wanted, and there were so many games that I wanted that I couldn't get all of them, you know? Yeah, that was my tradition every year at E3, back when E3 was actually on television and G4 was actually a channel and actually had video game stuff in it, because after a while, G4 abandoned the whole video game thing, and then eventually they folded and turned into the Esquire Network or something like that. But yeah, that was my tradition every year, is to watch E3 on G4, because nowadays, E3 is on Twitch or YouTube or whatever, but back then, it was on good old television. So yeah, I used to come up with a list of all the games that I really wanted, you know, during the holidays, and there were just so many of them, I couldn't get all of them. So there were so many great games coming out all at once. Compared to today, not so much. Back then, in the sixth generation, yeah, there were great games coming out all the time, but I just think the combination of all the great games that were coming out with the online gaming really taking off, as well as the introduction of the digital marketplace, I would go as far to say that the seventh generation was the greatest gaming generation of all time. Sure, I'm going to get a lot of flack for saying that, but I truly think that it was the best.